Good evening, everybody. Welcome, welcome. We're so glad to see you guys here. We are with Arts Connect. We are a nonprofit organization bringing all of the wonderful arts and enrichment programs to you here in Springfield Township. This is the final concert of our big evening summer concert series. And of course, it's sunny today. The rest of our concerts have been not so nice and they've been outside. So this is how we plan it this year. So we're glad to be inside in the air conditioning, and we're going to have a wonderful concert by the Cincinnati Civic Orchestra. Our concerts are made possible by our sponsors, and some of them are here this evening, and I'd really like to make sure that you guys go back and visit our sponsors who are here. We'd like to show appreciation to the YMCA, to Constellation Energy, Energy Alliance, Northside Bank, and Evergreen Retirements. Now, I would be remiss if I did not say that the concert here tonight is all by volunteers, and they actually volunteer and have had a long history of volunteering their concerts here in Springfield Township for many, many, many years, and they will be back again for the holiday concert. So this evening, we hope that you show your support to the Cincinnati Civic Orchestra with a donation. Tonight, we have a special treat actually in the back. So during intermission, I wanna make sure that you guys know that yes, our sponsors are back there. Go back and talk to them. The Arts Connect booth is back there. And several of the booths back there are doing giveaways. We will pull the drawings at the end of the concert. Arts Connect is giving away t-shirts and tickets to our upcoming theater performances. We are doing a show called She Sings Freedom. Fantastic show. We do live theater right here on a stage. This one is going to be a professor of musicology who will talk about the history behind the lyrics of some very, very famous singers. And then they will actually perform the song. So it will be a lot of fun. But also in the back tonight, we have a historical marker and a historical group that's back here celebrating a really exciting discovery. And that was the invention of the Reaper was actually right here in Springfield Township. So after a long research, they have discovered definitively that the inventor, Obed Hussey, did that invention here in Springfield Township. We have a huge historical marker that is back there, and then the dedication and installation for that marker will be on September the 9th at 11 o'clock. We invite you all to come down for that event, and they can tell you more about it in the back of the room. Just a couple of logistics, just so you guys know. Women's restroom over there. Men's restroom right there. Could everybody please put a huge round of applause for the Cincinnati Civic Orchestra.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for our national anthem. Thank you. gentlemen, to a concert of American music. We have gone through the orchestra's library and pulled out the very, very, very best of American music. And there's no better place to start than with the music of Stephen Foster. Stephen Foster spent a lot of his younger years right here in Cincinnati, down on the riverfront with the steamboats, spent a lot of time over in Kentucky, and was probably the quintessential American composer of the early years of our country. This arrangement we're doing, though, is a particularly interesting arrangement. It was done by a gentleman named Tobani, one of the leading orchestrators of the Grand Italian Opera. And as best as we know, he never stepped foot in the United States. He certainly never met Stephen Foster. But from American tourists visiting Italy, he heard them singing these fantastic songs. And he literally would walk up to an American tourist and say, "Do you know any of those American melodies written by that Foster guy?" And people would sing things for him, and he'd write them down in his notebook. And eventually he had them actually translating the words for him before he did this arrangement. Now, the arrangement works pretty well, except for one song, "Ring, Ring the Banjo." The closest they could get the banjo for him was mandolin. So it's not, I think, quite what Stephen Foster would have wanted. But considering that Foster never heard any of his music during his lifetime played by a full orchestra, I'm sure he would have been delighted to know that in later days he had become so famous that his music was being heard and performed as a great work. So we give you the gems of Stephen Foster. Any of you from Kentucky? We know you'll stand up during my old Kentucky home. Our first concert was in Northern Kentucky, and literally the whole audience stood up and sang, so that's okay. We know it's on the other side of the river. We know it's your national anthem, and we understand.
Thank you. Thank you.
Next, we're going to play the music that was used by Ken Burns for the, I want to say the theme of music, maybe the tie it all together music would be better for his Civil War miniseries that broadcast a number of years ago. It's a fascinating story how this music came to be. Ken wanted to emphasize the idea of brother against brother, of our nation torn apart during the Civil War. And as he put the miniseries together, he felt that he needed this melody in the background that was neither Northern or Southern, that was just this Civil War era melody to tie it all together. And he heard there was this young fellow named Jay Unger, who was one of the leading violin teachers in the United States, lived not too far from him. He got Jay's number. He asked Jay to come in and prepare 5 or 6 Civil War era melodies, and he wanted to sort of pick between them. As Jay remembers it, he prepared 7 or 8 melodies. His wife will correct him on stage and say, no, Jay, we prepared 9. He played his violin. She brought her stand-up walking bass and sort of put a bottom under it. And both of them are sure of one thing. Each melody he played, rather quickly, Ken Burns held his hand up and said, no. That's to this or to that or to the other. The first melody was actually one of the things played at the funeral service of Robert E. Lee. One of them was the marching song of the 15th Division of Maine. And it was all, at least in Ken Burns's mind, too attached to either the Northern or the Southern cause. And Jay's, he's young, and he got a little bit perturbed about this, so as his wife remembers it, he tossed the violin in the case and was ready to leave. And she said, no, Jay, wait, play the Ashokan music. And he said, that's not Civil War music. That's not, she said, Jay, it's what Mr. Burns is looking for. Just play it for him. And so he played this wonderful melody. Ken Burns started crying. He was just, that was just what he was looking for. And he said, I don't know that Civil War melody. And Jay Unger said, well, of course you wouldn't. I wrote it 3 years ago. It's what we play when the kids leave our music camp at Ashokan, New York during the summer when we're waving goodbye to them. And most of America thinks this gorgeous melody came from the Civil War. It actually, you know, came from New York just a few years ago. I've been very privileged to hear Jay play it down on our riverfront, to meet him, to know him, a wonderfully talented young man. And it's going to be my privilege now to play the violin solo, and my lovely wife Hildy is going to play the cello solo, and then after we open it, we'll be joined by the strings. So we give you the Ashokan farewell.
Thank you.
It's really a privilege to play music that beautiful. I was honored to have some really great teachers over the years. I was also very honored to teach for over 20 years at one of our local universities. All of the work you put in and all of the effort, when you get a chance to play music like that, it makes it all worthwhile to be able to give that away again. It's just such a great privilege. And, you know, any people that tell me we aren't writing music like they used to, I just tell them, listen to the Ashoka for a while. We're still writing great music, and there's a lot more to come. I don't know that I have a favorite piece of Broadway, but there can be little doubt that A Chorus Line is probably one of the most influential of all the Broadway musicals. How many of you have seen A Chorus Line? Community theater, high school, lucky enough to see it on the New York stage. It's quite a remarkable thing. You start off with all those young people in their leotards and whatever standing on stage hoping to get a job. They're in the chorus line. They're hoping to get hired. And the neat thing about this, and I don't think it occurred to Marv Hamlisch when he wrote it that it was going to go for years and years and years and years and be so popular, but the cast has to be 20, 21, 22, maybe 23. You can't just keep doing the musical forever because you start to look too old for the role. It doesn't make sense to have a guy 30 trying to get his first job. And so literally, if you go now and carefully read the bios of the leading stars of Broadway, they all got their start at almost everyone says A Chorus Line. And you know, the years, you know, vary over a 20-year period. It sort of was the place we groomed the next generation of our greatest Broadway artists. And it's just this amazingly American musical. There's a little soft shoe, there's a little ballet, there's a little honky-tonk, there's just a little everything in it. And yet, all of it is written to this unbelievable precision that only Marvin Hamlisch could do. Even Bernstein and Sondheim working together weren't as just plain, it had to be just right, as Marvin Hamlisch. How many of you have heard Marvin Hamlisch at Riverbend or some other concert? That 12-foot black, shiny Bösendorf piano, that's his piano. He's the only concert pianist I know that has a special airplane that he moved his piano with him. That's how particular he was. He didn't want to play on somebody else's piano. It had to be his piano. And we miss him dearly because he set a standard, and his music sets a standard of American music that may never be reached again. We give you really one of the great treasures, this fantastic, tight little arrangement of A Chorus Line that he worked on and that is just captures the whole spirit of everything that musical, but everything that Broadway is about, of young people singing their hearts out for us. We give you A Chorus Line.
Thank you.
Well, we're going to end the first half with probably the best-known piece of American music around the world by two of our very greatest composers, West Side Story, Leonard Bernstein, and Stephen Sondheim. Sondheim, at the time he collaborated with Bernstein on this, was only 21 years old. Bernstein had been trying for years to write his version of Romeo and Juliet, and he kept stopping. He just couldn't make it happen. And then with this fantastic, young, talented lyric writer, who also happened to pen some pretty nice melodies that appear in West Side Story, that Bernstein did the polishing on, he found his literal soulmate to make this great piece of American music happen. There could have never been a West Side Story if Bernstein hadn't pulled things together with Steve Sondheim. It took the two of them to make something this amazing happen. Sondheim commented once, wasn't he upset that he didn't get top billing with the maestro? And he said, how could I be upset? I got to work with Leonard Bernstein. You know, what's there to be upset about? What's there to be upset about when you look at our American music as one great composer passes the torch to the next and the next and the next? On the stage behind you, an all-volunteer orchestra, we have, I believe, two musicians that played under the baton of Aaron Copland, two of us that studied with and knew Leonard Bernstein personally, at least three musicians that have played as substitutes, backups in some pretty great American orchestras, and I think I count five of us that have recorded as backup players for everybody as diverse as Peter, Paul, and Mary and the string section of Chicago. You know, that's how American music works. We aren't the Europeans where somebody writes till they die and nobody knew what they were doing. We bring along each generation. We open our arms to the new players. There's a lot of new faces in the orchestra behind me. Some of them are folks that haven't played in years and came back. Some of them are folks that never got to play in an orchestra in high school or college that have come and they want the experience. But everybody around them makes it possible. And I think that's why American music is so special. I think that's why it's so different from what is being written in other parts of the world. It's this collaboration between generations, between people of different faiths and different cultures and different backgrounds that makes our music so alive. And there's nothing more alive than West Side Story. So let's enjoy the end of this first half of the concert with some Bernstein and Sondheim in a really amazing arrangement for symphony orchestra of the music from West Side Story. Thank you.
for fun now. How many of you, good number of you are in my age group, we all grew up with the early cartoons, Bugs Bunny and Company, remember all those? We didn't know at the time we were being force-fed classical music. The guys that did those cartoons hardly had enough money to make the cartoons. They sure didn't have the money to hire composers and orchestras and what have you. So they went to the public library in L.A. and they got out the 78 discs that they thought would sort of work for that. And finally, and this is to me pretty amazing. Warner Brothers ended up buying Bellwin Music Publishers. And Jerry Brubaker figured it out that all of that music was still floating around. And so he put it all together. Now, we're going to remember this as being cartoons. We're going to remember this as well, some of the craziest things. They talk about TV being violent today. You know, it was... Nobody made it through those cartoons in one piece. You know, anvils fell on them. They got blown out of cannons. And, you know, we're all there rooting them on, right? I know some of you don't have programs because we ran out. But we have everything here from the Barbara Seville to Liszt's Hungarian Rhapsody. There's the William Tell Overture. We got the Hungarian Dance by Brahms. And of all things, Wagner's Ride of the Valkyries. You know, those guys were writing music for the Grand Opera where really strange things were happening too, but nothing like an anvil falling out of the sky and crushing somebody. And they've rolled them all up into one, and this is absolutely delightful. So any of you younger folks in the crowd that don't like classical music, just hold on to your seat because you're going to go on quite a ride right now. Now, I do... get to be the voice of Bugs Bunny, and I don't do it real well, but I'm going to try.
Thank you. that's all, folks.
I hear we have the oldest resident of Springfield Township right here in the first row. Is that right? Maybe? How many years? 100. I don't think that's maybe. That's just fantastic. You love music. Well, you're in the right place. You got a girlfriend, too. I wouldn't touch that with a 10-foot pole, but that's okay. It's amazing how much music improves our lives as we grow older. Talking to your son-in-law, and when he 100 years, I was thinking about that. In this very chair, Maestro Roth was playing. Well, not the same chair, but he was playing as our concertmaster when he was 92 years old. And if his arthritis hadn't gotten too bad to play, he would have just been still playing today. And recently, a few of us got to play his 99th birthday, and it's like, you know, music just keeps your soul alive. And I don't understand why, you know, grandparents in the crowd, moms and dads in the crowd, get the young ones out to hear good music. You know, you don't just have them learn to play the piano or violin because it's going to improve their SAT scores. I mean, that's nice if they get a scholarship. But you do it because it's something they'll treasure their whole lives. And it's just wonderful to be able to do these concerts. I've got to tell you, the orchestra did you guys practice or something last week? I mean, they're really on tonight. This is really, really good stuff. So I'm having fun too. Thank you. We're going to do the Sound of Music next. This is probably the biggest arrangement we're doing this evening. Some of my favorite music. Do we have any real Sound of Music fans here? Yep, lots of hands. For those of you that know the musical well, I want to give you a little warning. Right toward the second half of the arrangement, we play a song called An Ordinary Couple, which is not performed with the musical anymore. It's sort of been swept away because they thought the musical was a little too long. And I want to help you all a little with how foolish box office managers can be about things like this. As you'll recall in The Sound of Music, after Georg and Maria marry, they come back, and the scene as we do it today is they arrive, they get out of the car, the kids run up, they give the kids their presents, the kids disappear, and we have the huge swastika hanging on the front of Georg's home, and he's very upset. And everything from then snowballs into getting out of Austria, climbing over the mountains, and we all know what happened after that. They ended up in Vermont. They ended up fighting against the tragedies of war and evil their whole lives. And it's hard to believe that these two people, in the face of such horrible times, could show that kind of courage. In the original musical, when they pull up in the car, there is no swastika on the front of their house. In fact, they go out on the terrace with the kids, and the kids open their gifts, and they're sitting there looking at the beautiful mountains, which at that point are their friends. They love the mountains, and they sing this song that all they want to be is an ordinary couple with their children at their knee, drinking tea. And you actually see them and the children happy in the world as it should be. And it's only in the next scene where the Nazis arrive and hang that banner, and they have to make the choice to run the risk of going across those mountains, maybe dying, maybe having their children die, but doing what was right. And it's such a different musical when you know what they're giving up. And it's 4.5 minutes, just this one little song, but it involved another scene change. It involves some lights changing. It involves some time. It involved a relatively difficult song for Georg to sing. And so they cut it out. And I've always felt like in the process of doing that, we lost a huge part of the humanity of this amazing piece of music. So when we're playing and you hear this wonderful, quiet melody that you don't recognize, know that that's when they're singing with the children around them, that they want to be an ordinary couple. And think about what that means. We give you The Sound of Music.
Thank you.
Before we do these last two numbers, I want to do a couple thank yous real quickly to everybody here broadcasting this on television. We've got camera folks, we've got Tony back in the truck. We've got people making all this happen. I have no idea technically what any of this means, but it's truly amazing to me that there are folks out there that I'm waving at that are hearing this that don't even live in Ohio. One of our musicians had some of her family that live in the islands hear this. One that was broadcast, I believe, last year. It's just, it's magic that this gift of music can just somehow go out to the rest of the world. It's just so wonderful. You know, I can remember when we were lucky to get microphones to work. And these guys are great, and they're volunteers too. And thank you so much, Waycross, for doing this, for being here in the communities. I want to thank everybody here from Springfield Township. We've had a wonderful, long relationship here at the Grove. This is the biggest crowd we've had in a long while. We had to bring more chairs in. I'm so glad that they have these new comfortable chairs. About 7 years ago at a holiday concert, we ran out of the old folding chairs, and we actually brought some park benches in that had snow on them, and people sat down on them. You know, it's great that you come. Now, I'm going to say something now that could get us in a whole lot of trouble in the long run, but I really, frankly, don't care. These people are all volunteers behind me. They do a fantastic job. The most important thing for them is to have all of you out there smiling and appreciating their efforts. I mean, if we came in and there were 25 people sitting in the room after hours of rehearsal and practice at home and everything else that it takes to make this happen, it would be just so horrible. And having you here is just absolutely fantastic. So the biggest gift you give this orchestra is your presence. And there's a couple empty seats over there. I know there's a few more chairs in the barn back there they could have brought in. A couple of the places we play are a little bigger. I mean, bring your friends. Tell them about these concerts. We've been doing this since 1929. We've never charged for a concert. It's right in our charter that our concerts will always be free. And we've managed to keep this going. I mean, can you imagine this orchestra being founded and less than 4 months later, the stock market crashes in 1929? If those people could keep it going without charging for tickets, we can keep it going. But we need you to be here. That's the most important thing. Now, as you leave, there will be a donations basket and no basket.
There'll be
a bag. There'll be something. There's a bag. Anne is the bag lady. Okay, good. I'm sorry, Dexter. I couldn't resist. Please, you know, make a donation if you can. And if you're not able, you've already given us the most important donation. You're all smiling out there. The other thing is, if you're not on the mailing list, take the little piece of paper in your program and get on the mailing list. It doesn't cost anything. We spring for the stamps. We've got volunteers to put the labels on. And that way you'll know exactly when the concerts are. You don't have to worry about what they get right or wrong in the newspaper or what some friend remembered and told you wrong. You get a postcard right in your mailbox that says, here's the next concert. And you can actually stick it on your refrigerator with a refrigerator magnet, and it'll keep reminding you when the next concert is. So get on the mailing list. Now, last but not least, I want to say a word or two first about the rest of the concert and then about next year. The rest of the concert, we're going to play two really unique pieces of music. We're going to play some George Gershwin for you. Now, Gershwin was not a great classical musician. He was a dance band guy. His Rhapsody in Blue was premiered by the Paul Whiteman Orchestra, not by Boston or Cincinnati or Philadelphia or the New York. I mean, he wrote for the people of America. And he was very surprised, actually, when the big orchestras picked up on what he was doing. And we've got this wonderful little arrangement of his music that you really feel the spontaneity of the music. And as soon as we're done playing it, we're going to play the Beach Boys medley. Now, I don't want any Gershwin fans to be upset with me, but the music is very similar. Because those crazy guys with their, you know, bleached out hair from being on their surfboards and on the beaches that just did, you know, California girls and I'll get around. I mean, they were having just as much fun making music for their crowd as George Gershwin had making music for his crowd. And there's the same spontaneity and life to the music. Now, when we're done playing them, we're going to do something we don't normally do. We're going to play an encore. We've been waiting for 3 years for the new and final arrangement of the music of Star Trek. Star Wars. Thank you. It's wonderful to have a whole orchestra correct after you. Oh, Star Wars. John Williams promised that this was going to be out 3 years ago, and he wanted to get it just right. I mean, this is the melodies from the whole thing, all put into one. And I called early before the summer concert started to our publisher, Lux Music, and they said, it's not going to be ready. You'll have to wait till next summer. And then I got a call back that, yes, they were starting to print them, and they thought they could ship it to us directly from the printer. Now, I want to tell you, when I cut the box open, and it wasn't from our publisher, it was literally from the printing house, the smell of the fresh ink almost knocked me over. I mean, literally, it was wet on the pages. And we only had a couple rehearsals, but this is Star Wars as every arrangement should have been done in the past. There's none of the stuff in between where there was dialogue or things blowing up or what. It's the melodies that will never, ever leave the world of music. John Williams has written some amazing melodies, and they just follow one after the other. And you see the whole variety of what he's written, plus just how rich this music is. I will tell you, a few years ago, we played the Darth Vader March for a bride and groom to go out to at their wedding. And, you know, 30 years from now, this music is going to be what we remember from this generation. 100 years from now, this is going to be remembered as we remember Beethoven and Mozart. John Williams has written some amazing stuff. And to see this whole compilation, these years of these Star Wars movies, just put together in a very tight package is really exciting. So we want you to hear that. Now, there's a second reason I want you on the mailing list. Next year is our 89th season. And the year after, we're going to start counting down to 100. Or you might look at it the other way, counting up to 100. The bottom line is we were planning in our 90th season to play the Haydn 90th Symphony, and then the 91st and the 91st season, and right on up to his great 100th symphony in our 100th year. And I realized that the 100th symphony, like his 89th symphony, were based upon really oddball concertos for an instrument called the lira origami, basically a hurdy-gurdy with organ pipes on it, that the King of Naples owned and had Haydn write literal concertos for. I think the only one that exists today is in the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. Really oddball instrument. But Haydn liked the melodies, so he used them. And I said, let's start off the 89th season. So we're going to give you, in the fall, the Haydn 89th Symphony, a fascinating work that is seldom performed. We're going to do the Beethoven 7th Symphony on the same concert. We're going to give you one of the superheroes medleys. I'm not sure which one we're going to use. And we're going to be doing the overture to Lohengrin by Wagner, all on the same concert. It's going to be a wonderful way to kick off this whole process of moving forward. Now, these concerts next year, we're going to call taking the next step forward. And what they're all going to have in common is the composers were doing something they'd never done before. The Beethoven 7th was the first work he wrote after he could not hear. In the winter, we're going to be playing the Franck D Symphony. He'd never written a symphony. He was a college professor telling all the young guys, do something different. Well, they weren't doing anything different. They were writing more Mozart. He got tired, so he did something different for them. And it just about caused a riot at the Symphony Hall in Paris. And then to end the whole march forward in the spring, we're going to do the Mahler First Symphony with an all-volunteer orchestra. And that concert will be my 400th concert conducting this orchestra, which is an amazing privilege for me to get to conduct the Mahler with these folks. So you want to be on the mailing list. You want to come for next year. So we're going to give you some Gershwin, and then the Beach Boys, and then especially those of you in the first couple rows, you should hook your seatbelts up right now for the Star Wars. You definitely don't want to not have your seatbelt hooked up. Thank you. Thank you all for being with us. And now, for the first time in Cincinnati, we give you Star Wars Through the Years.